All right. If you are watching this, it's because we need help with the quiz. So let's get started. Look, in this quiz, you're asked to graph the following linear functions. F of x equals 2x minus 4 and f of x equals 2x plus 1. What do you mean, Becker? What's up with that?
Well, I mean like graph both of them on the same grid.
Oh, should I said that? So how do we start, Becker?
Well, usually we start by giving values for x.
Okay, and how do we do that? How do you propose we do that? Okay, so this is what happens. Look at your graph. Your graph has a side that is, okay, this is 0 for x, okay?
So on this side are all the positive numbers for x. On this side are all the negative numbers for x. So we're gonna call this negative x.
Okay,
this is y, and therefore, these are all the positive numbers, so these gotta be all the negative numbers.
All right, perfect then. So, but how do we start graphing? Well, we need values. So this x is what we call the independent variable, and this is what we call the dependent variable. On the independent variable, you could just plug anything you want to, making sure that, remember, your graph does not limit itself to the positive values of x. It could also go all the way to the negative values, to these values, okay? So it's a good idea to give positive and negative values. In this case, the usual values that people give are, and why am I writing like this? Nah, doesn't matter. Okay, oh my God, this is green. All right, negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3. These are enough values to give for x. Okay, remember, in geometry, 2 points determine a line, however the points are. So with this many points, oh, we're set to go. All right then, so let's start. All right, so what else do I need to know? These are the values for x. Now this space here, okay, I left it so you could actually put, okay, so you could write down the machine. This is the machine, okay? This, whatever x is gonna get doubled and it's gonna get subtracted by 4, and then whatever I get, I put in here. This is a function of x, better known in the older algebra as y equals. Okay, remember, you could say y equals 2x minus 4, and that's why I put a y in here. Nice. So let's see now. Let's start working by hand. So 2 is over here. Now, the value of x, this quantity is read in the following way. 2 multiplied by the quantity x, and then subtract 4 from it. Okay, so 2 times the quantity x. What is the quantity x in this case? Negative 3.
Oh, Bex, you're nice. Of course I'm nice. 2 times negative 3 and minus 4.
See that?
Let's try here again. Let me close in. Let me zoom in a little bit more so, yes, we could see it. Later on, I'm going to zoom out. All right. Here we have 2 times the quantity negative 2 minus 4, because x in this case is negative 2. See that? That's how it goes. 2 times the quantity negative 1 minus 4. Then we have 2 times the quantity 0 minus 4. Then, look, x is 1, so we have 2 times the quantity 1 minus 4. Then we have 2 times the quantity 2 minus 4. Then we have, okay, I'm not gonna do this for you, right? So, now let's figure out what our resulting y would be. So 2 times negative 3 is negative 6. Now, negative 6, so you go on the number line to negative 6, and this is a command to go 4 units to the left. Ah, so then negative 6, and then what? Negative 7, negative 8, negative 9, negative 10. Ah, nice, negative 10. So then what you're gonna write in here is the following. Negative 3, comma, negative 10. Okay, one more, and then you're on your own.
2 times negative 2. Well, positive times negative is negative. So 2 times 2 is 4. 4, right? But this time is going to be negative 4 because positive times negative is negative. Negative 4 minus 4. Well, you are negative 4 and you're going to move minus 4. That means 4 units to the left. Ah, Bex, you are OD. Of course I am. So your order pair is negative 2, comma, negative 8. See that? And then just go on, go on, go on, and that's it. It's over. Okay, that's all you gotta do. Move on, and then, anyways, after a while, you could see a pattern forming. Look, negative 10, negative 8. So then this one must be negative 6, negative 4, ta, ta, ta. Okay? All right then. So once you have your table ready, then we are going to plot the points. Okay? So let me know when you're ready. Okay then, so now we are ready to graph, okay? So I hope you can see this. So let us graph. Oh, you know what? Actually, I zoom in and hopefully you'll understand what I'm saying. All right, so my first point is negative 3 comma negative 10. Okay, negative 3 comma negative 10. So how do I go about it? Well, look, 1, 2, 3. This is 0. So if I move to the left, I'm gonna go on to the negative y's. So I need to go negative 3 on the y. So this is negative 3 on the y's. Okay, I do not mark the point right here because we're not done yet. I went negative 3 on the y's, but now, on the x. But now I need to go negative 10 on the y's. Well, I'm certain that this is not the negatives on the y's. So, oh yeah, go down, right? Is it up or down? Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And that's how you plot your point. See, this point is negative 3 comma negative 10. Okay, let's take a look at our next point. Negative 2 comma negative 8. Negative 2 comma negative 8. All right, so let's go to negative 2 on the x, and then we're gonna go down to negative 8 on the y's. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yo, okay. I got 2 points. Let's take a look at the next order pair. What is the next order pair for you? Right, negative 1 comma negative 6. Beautiful. So negative 1 comma negative 6. Negative 1, you see, I go to the x first. Negative 1 and then negative 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And that's it. Now let me ask you a question. Do you think it is necessary for me to continue looking at the table? You remember the same way you found a pattern. Do you think I need to keep looking at the table and keep plotting the numbers like 0 comma negative 4, 1 comma negative 2? Do you think I need to keep plotting them, or do you think I can figure out where this is going? Okay then, so where do you think this is going? Where is this heading to? What's the pattern? Can you tell me? Correct! You go 2 up and 1 to the right. 2 up, 1 to the right. 2 up, 1 to the right. 2 up, 1 to the right. Let's check to see if it's true. Now that we know how to plot the points, can you tell me what this point is? Well, for x, where am I on the x? I'm at 0, correct. Where am I on the y's? I at 4? No, I'm at negative 4. Ah, of course. So this is 0, negative 4. Let's take a look at my table. 0, negative 4. No way, Bex. So I could just go on and on. I can explain every natural phenomenon. So, and that's your line. And if you want to go on and on and on, you don't have to rely on the table. You could just look. Go on and on, like 2 up, 1 to the right, 2 up, 1 to the right. And you'll find your table. Grab your handy dandy ruler and look. And make a line, come on, a straight line with the ruler. Boom, 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 boom. Okay, so what's next? Ah, remember, if you were taking the regions right now and you leave it like this, you would lose points. Why? Because you're not labeling the line. What is the name of this line? If you know it, tell me. All right, f of x equals negative 2x minus 4. Perfect. All right, am I done with this? No, of course I'm not done. I gotta do the other one. Oh, gosh. All right. So, once again, the same process. You need to give negative values and positive values. So, what are the negative values? We know it. Okay, we got the negative values. And then what goes here on the table? Later on, you won't need to create a table of values. You could just look at it and graph it, okay? So 2x plus 1. Mm-hmm. All right, so 2 times, what is the value of x? Right. 2 times, what is the value of x? Right. Two times, what is the value of x? All right, and in all these cases, I'm adding 1 to the machine, to the little industry. Yes. Okay, so let's talk about this. 2 times negative 3 is what? Correct, negative 6. And negative 6 plus 1, remember, negative 6. You're at negative 6, and this is a command to go to the right. So negative 6, what is this number? Right, negative 5. And then 2 times negative 2 is negative 4. Negative 4 plus 1, you're at negative 4, and you are going to move 1 to the right. So that's negative 3. 2 times negative 1 is negative 2, plus 1. Okay, 2 times 0, 0 plus 1. Anyways, do you see the pattern right now? Negative 5, negative 3, negative 1. So in other words, negative 5, negative 4, negative 3. Negative 3, negative 2, negative 1. Negative 1, 0, 1. So then 1, yes, 2, 3. 3, 4, 5. 5, beautiful, beautiful. And then, of course, here you're going to write your ordered pairs. Okay? So let's write order pair, the order pairs. Beautiful. And now we're just gonna plug them in. So now that you got the points, okay? You got the points. We're gonna plug them. Now, if you already know how to do this, please do not wait for me. Just go ahead, because you need to write an explanation, which I'm not going to write. All right, so the first point was negative 3, negative 5. So go negative 3 on the x, 1, 2, 3, and then go negative 5 on the y's, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, now what? The next point is negative 2 comma negative 3. Okay. Negative 2 for x, and then negative 2, and then negative 3 for y. The next point is negative 1 comma negative 1. Negative 1 comma negative 1. Oh gosh, guess what? I just saw the pattern. What is the pattern? Correct. Two up, one to the right. 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 You see how easy this is? Once you find a pattern, forget it. It's over. You own this game. Okay. Then you trace a big line. You see that? Make sure you put the arrowheads. If the arrowheads are not there, that is not a line. That is a line segment. Okay. What am I missing on this line? I got it, right? Oh, Becker said that if I don't label it, I'm gonna lose points. Okay, so let's label it. I'm gonna label it right here. So f of x equals 2x plus 1. All right then, so I'm done. I got it. Now, what is all this word thing is about? It says, explain in writing what steps or process did you follow in order to create the graph of your functions, okay? What did you notice about the behavior of both lines? What type of lines are they from your point of view? Well, actually, it's not even from your point of view. It's from, like, everybody's point of view. Well, I'm not going to tell you how you graph the functions, but I want you to tell me, look at the two lines and tell me what you notice about the lines. If you can come up with that, I'll give you 5 points. Okay? And that's it. That's the end of your quiz. Hopefully, it was of help to you. And now let's move on to something else. I wanted to move on to the lesson. So let's remove this and let's have the lesson ready. Okay, the first things first. We were reviewing, yeah, you like my math? Awesome, right? You got you, okay, good. It says, how do we use the writing process to solve linear equations? Okay. So we're gonna answer a couple of these questions right here, but definitely if you are shaky on how to solve linear equations, you need to memorize these 6 rules, okay? If you can memorize these 6 rules, there's nothing you cannot do. Because those are, I spent a lot of time doing this, and I know it's, I guess, perfect. So, first rule, look out for any distributive property. Second rule, are there any fractions? And look, I'm telling you what to do if there are any fractions. Please multiply the whole equation by the common denominator. Are there any like terms in the same side of the equation? If there are, please combine them. Are there variables on both sides? If there are, use the additive inverse of that variable. Of course, to get rid of it. Use the additive inverse if there's a number adding or subtracting. Usually there is a plus or minus between the variable and the number, like 3x plus 4. See the plus sign between the x and the 4, so we're gonna use the additive inverse of the 4, which is negative 4, the opposite. In other words, subtract 4. And then of course, then use the multiplicative inverse if there is a number that is multiplying or dividing the variable, all right? So for example, 3 is multiplying x, 4 is multiplying y, 7 is multiplying b, and so on and so forth. All right then. So let's do our first problem. Here, guided practice. Okay, hopefully everybody can see the numbers. If not, then I'm gonna have to zoom in. Okay, nice. All right then. So, let us start with this. This is an equation, it has two sides. So we're gonna solve it. If you already know how to solve it, as I said before, please, just by all means, do so if you know you're gonna get it right. If not, then you're going to have to abide by the rules. The first rule is there any distributive property? Okay, so we answer yes or no. Well, in this case, look, there is a number that is multiplying whatever is inside the parentheses. So we have distributive property. So we're going to say yes. And we're going to apply the distributive property. So look, negative 3 times 4x is, well, negative times positive is negative. So it's going to be negative 12x. Uh-huh. Negative 3 times positive 3 is negative 9. Okay, I'm done with this. Look, this plus sign tells me that I'm done with that. Now, guess what? 4 is followed by a parenthesis. Therefore, I have to use the distributive property. Okay, positive 4 times positive 6x is positive 24x. Positive 4 times 1 is positive 4. And then that equals 43. Right? So I did my first step. I executed the distributive property. The second rule is, do I have fractions? I call it frac. Do I have fractions? And the answer is no, I don't have any denominators. Oh, okay, so then let's move on to the third rule. What does the third rule say? Correct. Do we have lettuce and tomatoes? Do we have like terms on the same side of the equation? The equal sign is what divides the two sides. So do I have like terms here? No. Do I have like terms here? Yes. So I am going to combine the negative 12x and the 24x. So negative 12x plus 24x is 12x. So I cancel this out. I mean, not cancel it, but cross them out, sorry. Now, negative 9 and positive 4. I get negative 5. Okay, and that equals 43, which is this number. All right, what else? Well, the fourth rule says, are there variables on both sides? Do I have variables on both sides? I got variables here, the letter X, but I don't have anything here, so I'm gonna say no. All right. Rule number 5, use the additive inverse. Well, is there a number that is adding or subtracting the x right here? Yes, this 5 is subtracting negative 5. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use the additive inverse of negative 5, which in this case is positive 5. So bring down the 12x, 43 plus 5 is 48. And then is the last rule says multiplicative inverse. Okay. Now the multiplicative inverse of the number that is multiplying the x. What is multiplying the x? The 12? Okay, so if 12 is multiplying, then I'm gonna use the multiplicative inverse. Okay. What is the multiplicative inverse of 12? 1 over 12. I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, Becker, it's easier to just divide by 12 on both sides. And he said, I understand. That's the way you were taught. But there is a step before that. There is a step of that explains why you're dividing by 12 on both sides. Watch this. Remember what I said about a fraction? When you multiply by a fraction, you multiply by the top and divide by the bottom. So 12x times 1 is 12x. Divided by 12, right? 12x times 1 is 12x, and then boom, divided by 12. Okay, equals 48 times 1 is 48, divided by 12. Oh, look, it came out to be the same thing as if you were to tell me just divide by 12 on both sides. Yes, of course, but that's because you use the multiplicative inverse. Ah, come on. So the 12th cancel out doesn't mean that they become nothing. It means that 12 divided by 12 is 1. 1 what? 1x. 48 divided by 12. And you got it. You see? The equation was solved using the golden rules. Nah, Okay. Well, let's try a different one. Okay, let's try this one. Okay. There you go. So, let's use the rules. So the first rule, do I have distributive property? I don't see anything here. Nah. Okay, so I'm gonna say no. Second rule, do I have fractions? Do I really have fractions? OD, right? Of course. So then, what does the rule say if I have fractions? Can you go back and look at it, please? Correct. It says that if I have fractions, I must multiply the whole equation by the common denominator. Well, what do you think the common denominator is right here? Wow, you're really smart. Yes. 5 fits into 15, 3 fits into 15. So basically, if we were to look at the times tables, they all meet at 15. So I'm going to multiply the whole equation by 15. So don't be afraid of fractions. Now watch what happens when I multiply by 15. 15 times 2 is 30. 30 divided by 5 is 6. So this is going to be 6x. 15, oh, positive times positive, positive. So 15 times 1 is 15 divided by 3. 5. Oh, okay. I'm done with that side. Now onto this side. 15. Look at this. Remember when I say multiplying by a fraction is the same thing as multiplying by the top and divide by the bottom. Well, I can start dividing by the bottom first if I wanted to. So look, 15 divided by 15 is 1. And I'm still multiplying by the top. 1 times anything is itself. So the top remains the same. Yo, Bex, you're nice. Yes, I know. So watch what happened. From this tedious fractional or rational equation, we end up with something nice. Look, no fractions. You're nice. Yes, yes, I know. Okay, then. Now the third rule. Like terms. On the same side of the equation. So do I have like terms here on this side? No. Do I have like terms here? No. So I'm going to say no. Then I'm going to go on to say, okay, do I have variables on both sides? Well, yes, I do. Look. So what does the rule say about having variables on both sides? Use the additive inverse to get rid of them, but then always try to get rid of the smaller number. In this case, I'm gonna get rid of this 6x. What is the additive inverse of 6x? Beautiful, negative 6x. So what you do to one side, you do to the other. So now, negative 6x minus 6x is 0. And then you have 5. Bring down the 5. 7x minus 6x is 1x. And then you bring down the 2, or the negative 2. Now my next rule would be, my next rule is the additive inverse rule, right? Well, how do I know I have additive inverse? There is a plus or a minus between the letter that we want and a number. So we're talking about negative 2. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna use the additive inverse of negative 2, which is positive 2. Positive 2, boom. And now, 5 plus 2 is 7. Bring down the x. Negative 2 plus 2 is 0, so x is 7. Bada bim, bada boom, bada bam. Nice equation. Okay? All right, let's move on to the next one. Okay, so here we go. All right, so for this set of examples, what you're going to do is you're going to look at your name and see what column your problems are. Okay, so if your name is in column A, in group A, okay, in category A, whatever you want to call it, then you're doing this. After you finish this, you move on to category B until you find the top, okay? If you are in group B, then finish your problems and move on to group C. If you are in group C and this is too challenging, you can always go back to group A and work your way up, all right? So let us do this. Remember that the golden rules will never let you down. So let's see. Distributive property? No. Fractions? Answer me. Fractions? Okay then. Like terms on the same side of the equation? Nope. Variables on both sides? Yes. Okay, so get rid of the lesser one by using the additive inverse. Okay, and now, well, what was the rule? Let me see, first was distributive property. Then it was fractions. Then it was like terms on the same side. So, almost made an I or an E or an O. So this is like term, this is a T, okay. The fourth one is variables on both sides. Do I have variables on both sides? I did right here. So I use the additive inverse on the lesser one, okay, cool. The fifth rule is additive inverse. Do I have additive inverse? Remember, it's usually a plus or minus sign between the letter that you want and the number. Oh, okay, so additive inverse of this. Negative 9, what would be? It would be positive 9. So 3 plus 9 is 12, equaling, bring down the 3G. Negative 9 plus 9, they're opposites, remember? So they cancel out, become 0. And now, last but not least, you're going to use the multiplicative inverse. Multiplicative inverse of the number that is multiplying the G. So in this case, the multiplicative inverse of 3 is what? Right, 1 over 3. 1 over 3. I know this is tedious because you have been taught that you should just divide by 3. And later on, if you just want to do that, it's fine. But right now, I need you to become acquainted with the multiplicative inverse. So 3g times 1 is 3g. 3g and then over 3, right? Here, 12 times 1 is 12. Over 3, right? Okay. So now, here, the 3s will divide, becoming 1. 1 what? 1G. 12 divided by 3 becomes 4. And that's basically your answer to problem G. I mean problem G. To the first problem in group A. All right. Now, let me help group B. What do you have here? Well, you have negative 1/3 y equals 15. You have a fraction, okay, multiplying the letter. So whenever you just have a fraction like this at the end, then you could skip all the rules like distributive property, fractions, like terms, variables on both sides, and you could go straight to the last rule. Because there's only one number multiplying here. So we're gonna be using the multiplicative inverse. Okay? So what do I do with that? What is the multiplicative inverse? Well, multiplicative inverse of the number that is multiplying the y. So what is the multiplicative inverse of negative 1 over 3? Or if you wanna call it, what is the reciprocal of negative 1 over 3? It would be negative 3 over 1. Negative 3/1. So how does this work? Well, let's see. Negative times negative, positive. 3 times 1, 3. 1 times 3, 3. Why, right? Equals negative 3 times 15. You want to put negative 15 over 1, that's fine. But anyways, so negative 3 times 15 is negative 45 over 1. We really don't put, let me put it over 1, but really we don't need to. So now the 3 cancels out, they cancel out. 3 divided by 3 is 1, so 1y. And then this, I'm just going to write it as negative 45. See that? Good, right? Okay. Now, let us move on to group C. Okay. So, here, you have fractions. So, first, let's start. Do I have distributive property? No. Do I have fractions? Yes. If you have fractions, the rule says to multiply both sides by the common denominator. What? There's only one denominator here. So what could be the common denominator? 4, right? So we're gonna multiply by 4. I'm gonna switch pencils. Okay. So let us use the distributive property. All right. So 4 times 3 is 12 divided by 4. Is 3x. 4 times 5 is 20. Okay, and I'm done on this side. Now, let me try this one. 4 times 2x is 8x. So remember, it's on the other side so of the equal sign. So 8x. 4 times negative 6 is negative 24. And now, we continue with the rules. What's the next rule? Well, like terms. Do I have like terms on the same side? Correct, no. So then we use the next rule. Variables on both sides. Do I have variables on both sides? Yes, so let's get rid of the lesser one by using the additive inverse of that. So we subtract 3x from both sides. 3x minus 3x is 0. Okay, we don't have to write it down. The 20 comes down. 8x minus 3x is 5x. Minus 24. Now, after variables on both sides, which is the fourth rule, we use the additive inverse. Okay, additive inverse of what? Of the number that is adding or subtracting the variable. Well, in this case, look, minus 24. So I'm gonna use positive plus 24. Plus 24. Okay, this is not part of the handout. I don't know how this came to be. Anyways, so the negative 24 and the positive 24 will cancel out, leaving you with 5x. And 24, 20 plus 24 is 44. And guys, if you are already used to the multiplicative inverse, then we use it. If not, I will allow you to say divide by 5 on both sides. So if you divide by 5 here, you get 1x. And since we're in high school, 44 over 5 stays at 44 over 5. There is no need for you to turn this improper fraction into a mixed number. Okay? Or into a decimal. Just leave it like that. It's better like that. And of course, if you were looking at it, it would be better, right? Yeah, that'd be cool. Alright then. Now, I did some of these problems. Now it's your turn. I think you have enough help to figure out what these three problems are. All right. And then, of course, we got the extended activity or homework, right? So, work on it. Good luck. All right. Bye-bye.